Thank you for having me here. And I, something about me, I'm working as an architect. I co-founded two companies longer time ago with and do 15 more than 15 years of online advertisement and really work now on the scalable, low latency processing in all kinds of areas. So the thing where we want to talk about is things what you likely have all heard about is, oh, I need my my data faster, get the reports earlier. I have a lot of different job profiles which don't fit to my clusters. Job run times are not deterministic, and the jobs don't run very well. So that is a very, very common thing. And this I go through is basically why Kubernetes makes sense, how to get started. And the most important point is about cluster autoscaler. This is, I think, this is really the stuff for the future. Then some tips and tricks about the autoscaling, and then also how to use operators with Spark, and some final words. So Kubernetes, us, we big data guys, are working with cluster science a long time. What is the difference whether I have now another cluster like Kubernetes? It can be used for much more other thing, and the most important part is it has really a component in to do cluster autoscaling, means scale the cluster to the things what needed, but it also supports very good CI/CD stuff. It has a very good cloud support, and this is, I think, one of the most critical things for us right now. It's you get something which is provider independent, so if you use your deployment, you can run the deployment on any Kubernetes cluster typically, and yeah, you get much easier version handling, and it helps if you write good MapReduce or Spark jobs, which scales very well, you can leverage this really good because you can change job profiles very easily. Why cloud is? Because yeah, it's you only pay for what you use, and it makes a lot of operations for us easier. And there are a lot of provider in the market which runs managed Kubernetes for us, and this is a huge benefit because running a cluster, as you know, in the past with Yarn, it has all has some own knowledge skill requirements, and the cloud provider running this for you, running the backplane, but you still have use only the Kubernetes API, so you don't get locked in. My personal recommendation right now is Google JKE, which runs most finely for the most stuff we do, but there's also the Amazon AKS, Azure AKS, or DigitalOcean has a product, and many other guys also have products to run Kubernetes for you. So how, if we start using Kubernetes, there are some things where you need through things through. It's basically how to get a cluster, how to get the cluster up, and even if it's managed, you have to do something to get your cluster. There's basically two, from my side, recommended ways. Is one, use the provider native tools for that, or try to use Terraform to set up your clusters. But this is basically only the cluster, the infrastructure. To manage your own jobs is basically you should use Kubernetes native tools there. My recommendation here is Helm file. Kubectl, which is the standard tool from Kubernetes, and also leverage operators. This is a link which gives you a good starting point. What is available? And Helm file. Why Helm is basically you can say the YAM or for Kubernetes is it's a package management. Say it allows templating and well. You can provide values into this templating, And there's also, especially for a larger organization, you can have also chart repositories, which then can leverage by a couple of different groups. And there's also now public repositories where you find a lot of Helm charts, which addressing many needs of deploying standard components. But what you easily feel if you start using Helm, you get very long command lines and you have a lot of variance between your integration, your staging, and your production environment. And there I found another tool which was very helpful, what you can use on top of it. It's called Helmfile. It's basically, yeah, it's another YAML by where you define all your parameters to Helm, basically, and can also do a lot of on templating on your value files, which make it really easy, and you get relatively short CLI, and you still have one YAML file to document everything, what you can easily check in. And then you have with Helm, at least in the current version, always the security discussions about Tiller. There's a project called Helm Tiller, which basically runs, not Tiller, in a cluster, runs on your local machine with your own permissions and push the stuff in. And this this plugin make it easy to use. This whole stuff is very opinionated. So it's, I always say it's like Emacs and VI. There are many tools out, and you have to choose what best fits for you. But what also coming out of this environment, and this was introduced by the CoreOS guys, is basically the operator pattern, which has the thought to put basically the knowledge of the SRE or the domain knowledge of the special application, which you can't really express into the YAML files of Kubernetes, do this into code and have a standard interface to Kubernetes what this code can use to orchestrate this application in the right way, to do a backup, to scale up, to scale down, especially for stateful things like Kafka or Cassandra, or also Spark, make things easier to use for things. There are development kits out to make it easy for yourself, but there's also a growing infrastructure for existing tools. Now I come basically to, I think, what for us as guys which working with big data, the biggest change is. This is the small-looking component inside Kubernetes is cluster autoscaler, which basically means if your cluster, if you start a job with many pods and there is no capacity available, it automatically starts new capacity. And if your nodes are not used anymore, then the cluster scales down. And this basically allows us to say, to not run always a constant size of cluster, to run it really depends on the current load. And it makes sense, for example, if I have a good scaling job, to say, okay, I double the size for 2 hours. Instead of running the job 4 hours, I get the result in 2 hours. But it cost me the same because I doubled the size, so basically I spent the same amount of money but get the result in 50% of the time. And the cluster autoscaler basically allows us to automate this. And related to that is basically the things called about node pools to manage this. So what does the cluster autoscaler do it for us? As I said, if it scales up, if it don't find a free slot for a pod. And it also looks to the best fitting node pool for this particular pod and adds them. And in the same way, scaling down is it looks to nodes which are not utilized, evict them, or underutilized, and evict pods if it is possible. I come later to it. And an important part is it shut down nodes which are not used. So even if it used under the hood Amazon autoscaling groups or instance groups from Google, which do a random choice what they scale down, Kubernetes has built in a mechanism to really shut down the node which is not used, even that and so normal load don't get affected by that. This is, I think, a very important point. Node pools. Node pools is basically a way to say, okay, I group nodes which have the same specification. And you can, there are on different providers different names for that, but at the end, it's all. I always name them node pools. You can have static ones where you say it has 10 nodes with certain characteristics, but you can also have, where I'm talking about today, I can have dynamic ones which can, in a limit, scale from 0 to 1,000. And I say 1,000 and it really works. We had 2 weeks ago, somebody defined a node pool with 1,000 nodes and put autoscaler on it, and something went wrong, and we get the 1,000 nodes in 25 minutes. So the pod horizontal autoscaler scaled up the pods, and basically after 25 minutes, we was going from 20 nodes to 1,000 nodes. And they're doing their job. You have to make sure that you have your proper limits in it, otherwise your build runs out of control. But it shows that this stuff is really working. And as I said, they're basically under the hood based on implementation of the Amazon autoscaling groups or instance groups or depending on the provider. And where I also later will talk about is basically how I target pods to specific node pools or to specific nodes, and also on the other side, how I prevent that something else gets scheduled on that. Because you don't want to have this that on a node pool where you have a GPU, a general purpose web server is running, because it's much more expensive to run it. And this is where you basically, I say, you need to have this dedicated node pools. And you define the node pools to your requirements. And because node pools can scale to zero, you can have basically, if you want, for every job, a different node pool with a different profile, where you figure out that this job runs needs much more CPU but less memory, and on cloud providers where you're very flexible of defining your hardware, you can accelerate or save money on it, and but this also say again how to target the node pools. And there's basically two mechanisms what you have to use. One is to avoid that other pods get scheduled on the nodes. It's called taints. So you have to write tolerations to a specific pod to allow to run on that. And there basically introduced a bit of standard pattern and saying, okay, a label dedicated, and then special is for the name of this group of node pools, and no schedule means it's it should not scheduled. And you should always think of only doing the decisions at schedule time to make it easy for the scheduler. There's also a version of to say no execute, which do the checks at runtime, which put a huge burden to the scheduler because he has constantly to check this stuff. But it doesn't make sense because typically you don't change your nodes. You don't change the taints on the nodes, so the one-time check at the scheduling time is completely okay. Now it's basically the other side, how I get my pods scheduled on a specific node pool. There are two ways. The historical way is the node selector. At some point, it will be deprecated. And the future way to do it is to do it with affinity, node affinity, required scheduling, ignore during execution time. This is basically what I mentioned before. And you do there your selection term of what labels it should be run on. And there come another thing into play, that the node pools are typically immutable. So changing settings to node pools is typically not allowed. So you have to create new ones, which if you're using the default labels and the standard label, which includes the pool name, you always have to change your deployments that the node goes there. So basically use your own ones, which give you the freedom to create new node pools without changing the deployments, and they get used. You can basically do soft migration by calling the old node pool, make it static, so that the next schedule goes to the new node pool setting. And it also allows, it's basically the next important stuff, you can do fallback things. Basically defining, you run a preemptive node or spot instance-based node pool normally, but spot instances have the problem that they sometimes disappear, right? And what does then happen to your job if you basically find a second node pool based on normal demand? You can basically run there your job, and it automatically scale up. And the cluster autoscaler do something by default, so it has a component, at least what works good at GKE, looking to the node price, and so it normally use the preemptive ones, and if the preemptive one for whatever reason not available, use the other one. Or the more explicit way is to use again affinity for the things, where you basically can then define weights to your to your affinity and give basically the spot instances in higher weight, so it's higher likely that they get scheduled or something, the node pool get further to it. This also basically allow a network optimization thing. You know, typically you want, they say you should run your Spark job in three zones, which drives your network costs to the roof, and you also get some latency problems. What you can do with this trick, run it in one zone and have a fallback. Basically, if this zone goes down, you have your fallback pool in another zone, and then this scales up in there. Because from my experience point of view, if 30 or 50% of your nodes goes away, your job is anyhow get completely recomputed. So this could be something very helpful to go there. So some important stuff about the cluster autoscaling aware pod. There's a FAQ, what you should read about, and this is basically the cluster autoscaler do something unusual for Kubernetes, is do reschedule of pods if you allow it, to shrink down your cluster. And this works also, from my experience, especially in GKE, very, very good and smooth, and do a very good job. Oops. Then the other piece is, because you do autoscaling, and to get nodes, even if it's sometimes only a minute to get a new node, but on other providers, you have to wait 10, 15 minutes to get a node, it takes some time. And so, especially if you have low latency requirements to start your pods, or you want to make sure that you get everything if you want to start, you have to do something over-provisioning, which is also described in this FAQ, where you basically create dummy pods to request these resources, but on a lower priority class. So that you can leverage the Kubernetes feature called priority class to to do this. And as you start your job with the normal priority, these things get evicted. And you have to do something all the time. Then you do a deployment, or you do running one-time pods to do this. I'm a bit on time pressure, so basically, the important stuff to make also this very good usable and is the Spark operator, which is open source by Google, which make it relatively easy to start and always support this affinity in Tains. So there's also another one which and Spark itself right now doesn't really support that you can set this. With this operator, you can set affinities and taints to your jobs. And this is what, and also it makes the job definition very, very easy. And it completely supports this, that every job has his own cluster and gets his own size. And here you see basically how an operator interacts with Kubernetes. How many time I have? Yeah, so it's basically a short example. You can see it later in the things, how to run it. Important is here is that you can see that you can set these affinities and tolerations to work with the node pools well. There's an upcoming Spark feature called pod template, which will likely come in the next major version. You can do something similar, but from my point of view, it will be more complicated because you have more to deal with other stuff as well. There's a history server, a good way to do it via NFS and leverage the GCP file store for that. It's something where we have a good thing. Other interesting stuff is really think about this spot termination handler, especially if you are on Amazon, because you have then 3 minutes time to do something, which means for your Flink or Spark job, doing a checkpoint that you can restart later on that. On Google, it's a bit challenging because you have only 30 seconds time on that. And also there's a rescheduler because, as I said, Kubernetes by default doesn't do any rescheduling of pods if you not do things. This is a part which can move it around. And then another important part is don't write to the image itself. Always mount there a volume and do the write there. Use emptydir, even emptydir to memory can be a huge accelerator to your Spark jobs. And always specify the size. This is also to make your job stable. And if you have large images, especially if you're working with ML stuff and so on, it's likely you have long Docker pull times or even running into timeouts and have to do it in an init container. Load parts of that from an NFS server or mount a read-only volume, which you can mount on many servers as a workaround. Yeah, so summary is really Kubernetes together with the autoscaler and cloud really brings us into the dynamic world, and you can try out a lot, which was on the traditional model basically impossible to do. Thank you.
Okay, so very quickly, do you have any question? Does anyone here have a question?
I'm also around. If you have question, ping me afterwards or write an email, and I'm happy to discuss things.
Thank you so much. And thank you.